Okay, my name is Wing Commander Rajeev Srivastava. Before I start, I will request Mr. Deepak Sinha, who is the Nodal Officer from UP Government to IIT Kanpur, to give us a heads up on the kind of perspective that UP Government plans on the environment and energy.
Thank you, Rajeev ji. And my job is basically to make sure that the expertise of IIT Kanpur is used for public good. It's perhaps called translational research. So it started couple of years back, and I, being an alumnus from this place, I did my BTEC, passed out in 86. I have a special affinity with IIT Kanpur. And in last few years, we have some success stories also. For example, IIT is very good in blockchain. Being good is one thing, being useful to somebody else is something totally different. So we are implementing this in two departments in the government here. We are grappling with air pollution in India, and Ghaziabad, Lucknow, Kanpur are like, you know, I don't know what ovens should we call them, death ovens or... Two methods to tackle those, this MINAS, preventive and curative. Preventive is very long, government is making policies. So this particular is a part of preventive measure. But IIT developed an expertise in the curative part of the air pollution, which is called cloud seeding, artificial rains. We did 7 times in the IIT campus, and the air quality from 400, around 400 goes to less than 100. It's a very measurable, you know. We're also into a defense corridor, and the latest project is technologies from IIT Kanpur for the benefit of not only human beings, but for the forest department, biodiversity, animals. All this development has to be now under the purview of SDG, that is sustainable development, should be eco-friendly. Keeping this air pollution in mind, I am especially very averse and very particular to air pollution. So I've been doing some work, and fortunately Rajeev ji has been helping me a lot. I also requested director and deputy director IIT Kanpur about a month back. And just now Professor Ganesh, I think, told that they are opening a new department in energy in IIT Kanpur. So what Rajeev ji will present is one thing. My request to audience is, I take opportunity to the gathering of all these experts here from various parts of the world to basically tell whether this hydrogen economy is feasible or not, should we go ahead or not. Based on the prima facie, you know, assessment of what I was given, I wrote to the Central Environment Ministry about a month back. I wrote to the state government here in UP. Fortunately, the Environment Ministry has set up a committee based on what is going to be presented here to you. So once again, thank you very much, and I would look forward to your valuable suggestions in what is being presented from Rajeev. Thanks.
Okay, before I start, firstly, this presentation is not about any specific research in any particular domain. It is about the application of that research which UP government is planning to do, subject to obviously input from experts like you. Second is, in this seminar today we talked of socio-economic. I think there is one more angle that needs to be included, and that is strategic, because while we can give a lot of details when it comes to decisions by the government and by the nation, a strategic perspective invariably has great importance. So with that, I will start. My topic is hydrogen economy and transport sector options for energy security, employment and environment. So I will specifically talk of two options and three objectives. The options are hydrogen economy and transport sector options, so that we can achieve three objectives. The first objective is energy security, Second is employment, and third is environment. Now, there's a reason why I have placed environment as the last, which you will understand as the presentation progresses. Because we are talking specifically of India, and within India, specifically of UP. Therefore, even when we want to improve the environment, we have to choose a path that is more acceptable to the state and to the nation. So let's firstly get a perspective on India and the state of UP. India is a poor country, barely capable of feeding or defending itself at the time of independence. We lost territory in 1948 to Pakistan and to China in 1962. Today, we are among the top spenders on defense. India faced famines in 1966 to 67. We had to import food grains. Today, India is the second largest producer of food grains. The mindset was primarily socialist till about 1991, when liberalization unleashed the economic potential. Today, India is the fifth largest economy and poised to be the third largest by the next decade. The democratic credentials of India are impeccable. But these credentials limit drastic action on population, unlike, for example, China, which could implement a one-child policy. That kind of policy is not even possible in India. Because of rising population, even though a lot of people are coming out of poverty, poverty continues to be a problem. So India is a peculiar case. It's a low-cost, struggling economy with serious strategic threats, and therefore, environment tends to take a back seat. We are aware of the environmental concerns and committed to move in that direction. India is amongst the leaders in renewable energy, and recently you must have seen that the target for renewables was met years in advance, which is 175 gigawatts, and now the next target has been set as 450 gigawatts. So that shows our commitment to renewables and in turn the environment. Like Deepak mentioned, we have the cities with the highest pollution levels in the world. On 4th of November, the pollution index in Delhi was 1,500. There is no scale which even measures that. They had to, you know, deploy special testing equipment to measure that. It only measures in three digits. After that, it goes beyond that. 2 days after Diwali, it was 1,567. That is the level of pollution. It was actually difficult to breathe. Now, this criticality is well understood. So, therefore, what we are looking for is viable solutions and not necessarily the templates which are suited for other nations. So when you look at industrial versus transport sector pollution, there are many sectors responsible for pollution. But for this presentation, we are focusing on the transport sector. Because industrial pollution is far more complex to handle. The government itself has got a lot of limitations. Like the previous speakers had brought out, there are a lot of implications in terms of employment, the social stress when industrial get closed down or they have to undergo changes. Then measures like relocation of industry can only be taken in exceptional cases. It cannot be deployed across the board. Lastly, a country like India cannot afford to shift its focus from economic growth, even if it comes to at the cost of environment to some extent. That is a compulsion. That's an imperative. But when you look at transport sector pollution, the incremental methods are possible. You do not have to revamp the transport sector as a whole. Initiatives can be taken which can snowball over a period of time. Already, important methods are in place, like electrification of railways or investment in public transport. These are under government control. private vehicles are the major concern. Because the economy does not permit the level of subsidies that countries like US and China can offer. And without these subsidies, all your EV adoption just does not happen. Because individuals will take their independent decisions based on what is economically rational. And also depending upon the operational feasibility of what he is acquiring. Need to find viable solutions in road transport which will meet the triad of objectives: energy security, employment and environment. Now technology is in a state of flux, because of which you can see clear-cut decisions cannot be taken. You must have seen the flip-flops even by the central government on its EV policy. There was a time when it was subsidy was promoted, then it was withdrawn, then it was modified. Now it is only for public sector vehicles but not for private sector, and so on. You can see the entire policy is in a flux. Then the cost of setting up infrastructure is a major concern. Either the government spends, which the government has got constraints, or the private sector comes up. But unfortunately, that's not happening because they have their reasons. So electric vehicles are the current favorite, but there is an interesting development that the moment subsidies are removed, no one wants to buy EVs. So if you look at the subsidy levels in China, which is the highest, $13,500, which is more than the price of a car that a typical Indian buys. The I would say model price of a car in India would be close to $7,000 to $8,000. In China, the subsidy is almost double that. In US, it is about $7,500. Now, even then, whether it is China or US, EVs have not been able to become mainstream. If you look at India, less than 1,000 sell in a year. In an auto industry which produces 2 million vehicles per year, it is not even 0.01%. That is the kind of penetration EVs have achieved. There was an experiment carried out in Nagpur with about couple of hundred vehicles. The experiment flopped. It was a private-public sector partnership. It simply did not work out. So basically, any option that is based on a perpetual subsidy does not make economic sense. Then when you look at environment, lithium is highly toxic. So it may clean up the air. When you dispose, it can create a very high level of toxicity in the underground water. So your pollution objective is actually not achieved. Lastly, there is a very important consideration of strategic dependence on China. Though lithium is found in several countries across the world, in the last 20 years, China has made strategic investments in lithium mines. And today has a monopoly of over 85% of the lithium supplies across the world. Now that is a very important consideration for India. You must have seen that once we correlate lithium with the dominance of China, it becomes a strategic perspective. When you look at China, at every international forum, they have opposed us. In the United Nations, they have opposed us. In the United Nations Security Council, they have opposed us. In nuclear supplier group, they have opposed us. In FATF, they have opposed us. So therefore, creating any kind of strategic dependence of China is definitely not advisable. Then when you look at the price of lithium, from 2015 to 2019, you can see a sharp rise. Obviously, I can't predict what the price of lithium will be in future, but one thing is certain. The downside is limited, but the upside is completely uncertain. So now, going by basic economics, if the demand for lithium increases and the supply is under a monopoly, you can expect the prices to rise. I'm just talking about basic economics. Now, as far as other battery technologies are concerned, like metal layer batteries, they are still in lab state. As of now, nothing is commercially deployed. Therefore, we come to hydrogen. Okay, currently it lags in adoption compared to EVs. The primary reason is infrastructure and supply. More than what is happening in the labs, it's time to look at what is happening on the road. Now, hydrogen initiatives primarily led by private companies, Toyota, Honda, Hyundai, Nikola One, and so on. Currently, trucks are the and high-end cars is where they are focusing on. And in fact, Nikola One claims that the total cost of ownership of hydrogen trucks is lower than that of diesel because of high life, lower maintenance, and so on. Next is, it is truly zero pollution. No air pollution, no water pollution. Now, there are multiple options in production. You can produce it from natural gas and electrolysis. And within electrolysis, there are different methods. Now, even if it was slightly more expensive, let's say by 20 to 40%, because the entire production can be indigenous, it makes sense. Because the government will recover that premium through multiple iteration of taxes. So you can see it meets most of our objectives. Local generation means it will lead to employment. Most importantly, it is the only solution to surplus power in the grid. Exactly like Germany, one of the reasons that they are focusing on hydrogen is because they have excess power in the grid. India already has reached a stage where a peak power deficit is only 0.8%. Now when additional solar energy comes up and wind energy comes up, we will be seeing a glut. So either the prices will drop and the entire sector will become sick, or we can convert it to hydrogen, protect the power sector and also our environment. Since the raw material is indigenous, the entire production can be indigenous. And immediate adoption can be through hydrogen blending in CNG. Cost parity with EV, it's already on the way. But the basic argument is, even if cost parity with EVs is not achieved, hydrogen is preferable. Coming to the last transport sector options, hydrogen is not the only option for zero pollution. Our objective is zero pollution, not EV or hydrogen. So look at, when you look at intra-city buses, overhead traction is the best. You're directly converting energy into transportation without using battery, without using hydrogen. Now this is already there in several countries, Germany, Austria. The Austrian model definitely suits us better because those buses have got rubber tires and they run on normal roads, unlike trams for which special tracks have to be laid. Then you already have, next option is compressed air vehicles. Tata Motors already has a tie-up with a company in France, MDI, for developing compressed air vehicles, which they are launching next year. This is the best option for intra-city, short distance, small vehicles. Now, if EVs have to be inducted, the preference would be for metal air batteries, but well, they are still in the pipeline. Then biofuels. Biofuels are a good option for India because they are carbon neutral. The long distance, larger vehicles, hydrogen is the best option. And for 2 and 3 wheelers, we can have biofuels and EV. Since most of these initiatives will take 5 to 10 years to materialize, currently the best option that we feel is to subsidize the hybrids. Now, hybrids are of two types. One is mild hybrids, where there is a small battery and the starter motor is redesigned to give a push to the engine so that the engine can be smaller and do a little bit of regenerative braking. This can lead to a mileage improvement by about 10%. And the other is plug-in hybrid, which gives you a lot of reduction in fuel as well as a smaller battery. Thank you guys. This presentation was possible with various inputs from IIT Kanpur. Special thanks to them.